Assalamualaikum and hello. In this video, I would like to explain the effects of groundwater table on the bearing capacity of shallow foundation. There are three cases that we have to consider depending upon the location of the groundwater table. First, let's take a look at this diagram. Let's say we have a footing with the depth of the footing DF. The width of the foundation is B, and then the groundwater table is located between the ground surface and the base of the footing. Let's say the location of this groundwater table is indicated as D sub 1, measured from the ground surface to the water level. And then the distance from the water level to the base of the footing is D sub 2. So in this case, the unit weight of the soil above the groundwater table is indicated as gamma, whereas for the unit weight of soil below the groundwater table is indicated as gamma sat, or in other words, saturated unit weight. So in this case, known as case 1, the location of the groundwater table is indicated as D sub 1 greater than or equals to 0, and D sub 1 is less than DF. D1, again, is measured from the ground surface to the groundwater table. And then DF is the depth of the footing measured from the ground surface to the base of the footing. So in this case, let's say this is the equation that we're going to use to calculate the ultimate bearing capacity. In this case, I chose Terzaghi's equation for square footing, expressed as 1.3c multiplied by n sub c plus q and q plus 0.4 gamma b and gamma. This is c term, q term, and gamma term. Right. When we have this condition, there are certain parameters or certain values that we have to change, taking into consideration the location of the groundwater table. So, in Q term, here, this Q, if you remember, it is the stress at the base of the footing due to the weight of the soil from the ground surface to the base of the footing. So, because of the existence of this groundwater table, we have two different unit weight of soil, from ground surface to the water level, and then from the water level to the base of the footing, meaning we have two different unit weights. So we have to take into account both unit weights to calculate Q, that is the stress at the base level of the footing. So this Q is expressed as gamma multiplied by D1 plus gamma saturated minus gamma water multiplied by D sub 2. Right? So, in this case, we consider this Q is expressed in terms of effective stress. Right? So, gamma multiplied by D1 plus gamma saturated minus gamma water multiplied by D sub 2. This is the normal calculation to calculate stress, what you learn in soil mechanics. Right? So, that is in terms of Q term. Another term that we have to take in consideration when we have a groundwater table, in this case, between ground surface and the base level of the footing, is the gamma term. Gamma term here. So, in this gamma term, we have this gamma. So, which gamma that we have to use? So, gamma in the gamma term here is expressed as gamma prime or effective unit weight, which equals to gamma saturated minus gamma water. Okay, so you have to make sure that you choose the correct parameter when you have to calculate the value of Q here, and you have to calculate the gamma term here. This gamma here, you have to be careful, because gamma here, you have to take the value of unit weight below the base of the footing. So in this case, below the base of the footing is below the groundwater table. So you have to express in terms of effective unit weight, that is gamma sat minus gamma water. So this Q is gamma D1 plus gamma sat minus gamma W minus multiplied by D2 to be included in this Q. And then gamma prime, you have to substitute in this gamma. So gamma prime equal to gamma sat minus gamma W. That is the case 1. Okay, now let's move on to case number 2. When we have a footing, just like before, the depth of footing is df, and then the width of the footing is b, but now the location, the groundwater table is located below the base of the footing. So let's say the distance from the base of the footing to the surface of groundwater table is indicated as small d. Yeah? So case 2, if this is the case, small d, the distance from the base of the footing to the surface of groundwater table, small d greater than or equal to 0, and this d less than or equals to b, that is the condition. If the condition is satisfied, then let's say we use this equation to calculate the ultimate bearing capacity. Okay? So the Q term here, the Q is equal to gamma multiplied by df, because the groundwater table is below the base, so the Q, which is the stress at the base level of the footing, is due to the weight of the soil from the ground surface to the base of the footing. The unit weight of this soil is indicated as gamma. So Q is equal to gamma multiplied by D sub F. Whereas in gamma term here, we have to change into equivalent unit weight or gamma bar. This gamma bar, if this is the condition, right, is expressed as gamma prime plus d over b multiplied by gamma minus gamma prime. So this gamma prime is the effective unit weight, which is equal to gamma saturated below the ground water table minus gamma water, right? So this gamma in the parenthesis is referred to the gamma above the water table. Okay, so when this is the condition, Q in the Q term is calculated as gamma multiplied by df, unit weight of the soil above the groundwater table multiplied by the depth of the footing. Whereas gamma in the gamma term, we have to calculate in terms of gamma bar or equivalent unit weight, which is expressed as gamma prime plus d over b multiplied by gamma minus gamma prime. Gamma prime equals to gamma saturated minus gamma water, and this gamma is the unit weight of soil above the water table. Okay. So the third case, the last case, is when this d, referring to this figure, this d, the distance from the ground, from the base of the footing to the surface of the water table, greater than b, greater than the width of the footing, then the groundwater table has no effect on the bearing capacity. So these conditions, case 1, case 2, case 3, are applicable in both theory by Terzaghi as well as applicable to Meyerhoff-Hansen's equation. Okay, now let's take a look at one example, how to calculate ultimate bearing capacity with the presence of groundwater table. This is the example. We have a rectangular footing with the dimension of 1.5 meter multiplied by 2 meters. And then the depth of the footing here from the ground surface to the base of footing is 1.2 meters. These are the soil properties. Unit weight equal to 18 kN per meter cubed. And then we have saturated unit weight equals to 19 kN per meter cubed. internal friction angle of the soil equals to 33 degrees and the cohesion C equals to 0, meaning this soil is a granular material like sand or gravel. Right. Now the problem statement here is calculate the ultimate bearing capacity Q sub U using Meyerhoff-Hansen's equation if A, groundwater table is at 1.8 meters below the ground surface. 1.8 meters below the ground surface. And then B, groundwater table is at 0.5 meters below the ground surface. Okay, this is the Meyerhoff-Hansen general equation for ultimate bearing capacity. Right? So, since C is equal to 0, then C terms cancel out, becomes 0. Now let's take a look at the Q term and gamma term. Right? So based on friction angle equal to 33 degrees, so you can find the bearing capacity factors you refer to table by Meyerhoff-Hansen in any geotechnical engineering book. So for friction angle equal to 33 degrees and sub Q equals to 26.09 and sub gamma equal to 35.19. Okay, the next step we have to determine the shape factors. Shape factors referring to F with the subscript of S. Here in for the Q term FUS, for the gamma term is F gamma S. So FQS is expressed as 1 plus B over L tangent phi. So equals to 1 plus B. The dimension of the footing, the width, is 1.5 meter, and then the length is 2 meters multiplied by tangent 33 degrees. So FQS equals to 1.487. Now we move on to F gamma S. F gamma S is expressed as 1 minus 0.4 B over L. So 1 minus 0.4, B is the width of the footing, 1.5 meter, and then L is the length of the footing, 2 meters. So F gamma S equals to 0.7. So the next step is to calculate the depth factors. Depth factors. So when we use Meyerhoff-Hansen's equation and then we have to calculate depth factors, there are two conditions that we have to consider. One condition is when df over b is less than or equal to 1, and another condition is df over b greater than 1. So we have to determine which condition. So in this case, the depth of footing df is equal to 1.2 meters, and then the width of the footing is 1.5. So 1.2 divided by 1.5 less than 1. Right? Less than 1. So less than 1. So we refer to the case of df over b less than or equals to 1. Not this case. So when we have decided this is the case, then FQD, depth factor for Q term, is expressed as 1 plus 2 tangent phi 1 minus sine phi squared df over b. So insert the values 1 plus 2, 1 plus, 1 plus 2 tangent 33 degrees, 1 minus sine 33 degrees squared DF over BDF is 1.2 meters, B is 1.5 meters. So, comes out as 1.215. And then, F gamma D, that factor for gamma term is equal to 1. Inclination factors. Since it's not mentioned, the load is inclined, then we assume that the load is vertical. So if that is the case, beta equal to 0, vertical load. So FQI is expressed as 1 minus beta divided by 90 degrees squared. Since beta is equal to 0, so 0 divided by 90 is 0 squared, so it becomes 1. Similarly, for F, gamma I is equal to 1 minus beta divided by internal friction angle squared. Again, beta is equal to 0, then 0 divided by internal friction angle, 33 degrees, 1 here. So 1 squared equal to 1. After we have determined the bearing capacity factors, N sub Q, N sub gamma, shape factors, depth factors, and inclination factors, now let's take a look at the groundwater table. What are the effects of groundwater table on the ultimate bearing capacity? Let's take a look at case A first. When the groundwater table is located at 1.8 meter below the ground surface, 1.8 meter below the ground surface, and then remember the depth of the footing, DF, is equal to 1.2 meter. So in this case, it means that the groundwater table is located below the base of the footing. When the groundwater table is located below the base of the footing, then we have to check how far the location of the groundwater table from the base of the footing. Meaning, we have to determine the small d to indicate how far the groundwater table from the base of the footing, right? So, since the location of the groundwater table is 1.8 meter below the ground surface, and then the depth of the footing is 1.2 meter below the ground surface, so small d is determined by 1.8 meter minus 1.2 meter, so the d here is 0.6 meter. And then we have to check which case. Is it case 1? Case 1 is for the groundwater table located between the ground surface up to the base of the footing. So case 1 will not be considered. Case 2 is when the value of d, the distance from the ground, the distance between the base of the footing to the surface water, between 0 until B. So in this case, 0.6 is less than or equal to B, because B, the width of the footing, is 1.5 meter. So we have to consider case number 2. So when we have to consider case number 2, take note that what happened to Q in Q term and what happened to gamma in gamma term. So refer to case number 2, in Q term, if you remember what I said previously, is expressed as gamma multiplied by D sub F, because this Q in the Q term represents the stress at the base of the footing due to the weight of the soil from ground surface to the base of the footing. Now, since the groundwater table is below the base, So we have to use unit weight of the soil above the groundwater table, which is gamma, equals to 18 multiplied by 1.2. That is the expression for the stress at the base of the footing, or small q. In gamma term, since we are considering case number 2, then gamma in the gamma term, we have to change to gamma bar, equivalent unit weight, which is expressed as gamma prime plus d over b multiplied by gamma minus gamma prime. Okay, gamma prime is effective unit weight, which is expressed as gamma saturated minus gamma water. So for simplicity, let's use gamma water equal to 10 kN per meter cube for simplicity. If you like to use 9.81 kN per meter cube, it's also okay. But for simplicity, as I said, we use 10. So gamma bar equal to gamma prime here is this effective unit weight, saturated unit weight, 19 kN per meter cube minus unit weight of water 10, plus this small d, 0.6, divided by b, the width of the footing, 1.5, multiplied by gamma. Gamma is the unit weight of soil above groundwater table, which is 18, minus gamma prime, again, 19 minus 10, 19 kN per meter cube minus 10. So we'll get gamma bar equals to 12.6 kN per meter cube. After obtaining these values, then we insert into the ultimate bearing capacity equation. So Q sub U equals to Q, which is 18 multiplied by 1.2 unit weight multiplied by the depth of the footing, and then multiplied by N sub Q. You refer back value of N sub Q, which is 26.09 multiplied by FQS 1.487 multiplied by FQD 1.215 multiplied by the FQI equals to 1, and then plus, these are the Q terms, and then gamma term, 1 half multiplied by gamma bar here is 12.6. B is the unit width, the width of the footing, which is 1.5 meter, and then multiplied by N gamma, which is equal to 35.19 multiplied by F gamma S 0.7, F gamma D 1, F gamma I 1. So if you calculate this one, you will get a value of 1250.94 kilonewton per meter square. Right? So this is Q. That is the stress at the base of the footing, unit weight of the soil, 18 multiplied by 1.2, the depth of footing, and then this is N sub Q, FQS, FQD, FQI, and then 1/2 gamma bar, B, N gamma, F gamma S, F gamma D, F gamma I, so we get 1250.94 kilonewton per meter squared. That's how we calculate ultimate bearing capacity when the groundwater table is located below the base of the footing, but the distance from the base of the footing to the surface of the groundwater table is less than the width of the footing. Okay, let's move on to part B. When the water table is situated 0.5 meter below the ground surface, So in this case, the water table is located between the ground surface and the base of the footing. So we are referring to case number one. Case number one. So in case number one, in Q term, Q, the stress at the base of the footing, we express in terms of effective stress, so equals to unit weight of the water, unit weight of the soil above the groundwater table, multiplied by the thickness of the soil from the ground surface to the groundwater table, plus the effective unit weight of the soil, gamma prime, multiplied by the thickness of the soil from the groundwater table to the base of the footing, which is indicated as B sub 2. So, should be equal to 18 multiplied by 0.5 plus effective unit weight is saturated unit weight minus unit weight of water. So, saturated unit weight of the soil is 19 minus unit weight of water is 10 multiplied by D2, the thickness of the soil from the groundwater table to the base of the footing. So, the depth of footing is 1.2 meters. And then the thickness of the soil from ground surface to the groundwater table is 0.5. So, the thickness here is 0.7 meters. Right? So, in gamma term, the gamma we express as effective unit weight gamma prime, which is equal to gamma sat minus gamma water, which is equal to 19 minus 10. Okay, so let's insert the values into the ultimate bearing capacity equation. Right, Q sub U. Right, so C term cancel out because C equals to zero. So we start with Q term. Q, which is expressed as 18 multiplied by 0.5 plus 19 minus 10 multiplied by 0.7. This is the Q, the effective stress at the base of the footing. Multiplied by N sub Q, which equals to 26.09, multiplied by FQS 1.487, multiplied by FQD 1.215, multiplied by FQI equals 1, plus 1/2 gamma, use effective unit weight, so 19 minus 10 multiplied by B, the width of the footing, is 1.5, and then N gamma 35.19 multiplied by F gamma S 0.7, F gamma D equal to 1, F gamma I equals to 1. So if you calculate this equation, the answer should be 887.47 kilonewton per meter squared. Okay. So now, this is the answer for the ultimate bearing capacity due to the existence of water table between the ground surface and the base of the footing. So in these two parts, A and B, I've shown you how to calculate the ultimate bearing capacity using Meyer-Hansen's equation. The same concept will be applied if you use Terzaghi's equation. Right. So since in these two parts A and B, I just show you the ultimate bearing capacity, if you are required to calculate allowable bearing capacity, if you are required to calculate allowable bearing capacity, let's say Q allowable, so simply Q sub U that we have calculated divided by safety factor. Okay? In addition to that, if you are required to calculate the allowable load that can be carried by the footing due to the conditions, so Q allowable, the capital Q allowable, represent the allowable load equals to small q allowable from this equation multiplied by the area of the footing. Similarly, if you are required to calculate q net allowable, it's simply q sub u that we have calculated minus q. This q, okay, effective stress or the stress at the base of the footing, and then divided by safety factor. Then, if you are required to calculate the net allowable load, capital Q to represent load, net allowable load is equal to Q net allowable multiplied by E sub F. Right? So the Q allowable here is the total allowable load from the structure plus the width of footing plus the soil above the footing. So gross, total. Whereas for this Q net allowable, referring to the load, the allowable load from the structure only. Okay? So I hope everybody could follow what I've shown here, how to work on the problem when it involves ground water table. So I think I have to stop here until we meet again next time. Thank you.